Thank you. going on? Welcome to Liberty Live Online. We are glad you are here.
Just let you do your thing, Kyle. Just let you do your thing.
Jenny, no pep in your step this morning.
I really am excited to be here. House of the Lord, it's Sunday.
It is an awesome time to be in the house of the Lord.
Amen.
We are so excited you're here. If it's your first time, welcome.
Yes.
You're not here on accident. Make sure you fill out the online connection card. Let us know it's your first time.
That's
fill
right.
it out at libertylive.church.
/connect.
Let us know. We'd love to get to know you and get you plugged in here with the Liberty fam.
That's right. And there are so many ways you can get plugged in, folks. We got the online campus family Facebook group.
Join it
if you're on Facebook. We got a 24/7 prayer chat in there. We have a ladies' Bible study going on right now in there. We got the one-year Bible plan. You can share your prayer needs on our wall of miracles. There's just a lot going on in there. It's a great family way to connect with everybody that watches online.
Mm-hmm.
And today, the spring group semester kicks off.
Begins.
If you're not in a group, join a group.
Yep.
LibertyLive.church/groups. You can find
one. Convenient.
How convenient, yes. You can find one wherever you are. We've got online groups, too, if you don't live in the area or if you live in Hampton Roads and you want to connect with people in person during the week. We've got those too. So
something for everybody.
That's right. Check out our website. Join a group.
Great
to do life
online, in
with
person.
Others.
Get connected with the Liberty fam in a lot of different ways. Groups, Facebook group, everything.
That's right.
It's a good time.
And you know what else is a good time?
Student camp.
Yes. Thank you.
Woo!
Summertime.
Summertime is
sweet
coming.
Summertime.
We got a lot of activities for the little ones. And the medium-sized ones.
The littles and the mediums.
Meaning the kids and the students.
Yes,
meaning
you.
We got Kids Week registration. Sign them up. Kids clubs, VBS. You're not going to want to miss it. It's going to be good. And then student camp as well. Sign them up. We got some deals right now, don't we?
Yeah, I think we're running out of time on the deals. I think right now you get $50 off.
The deals are slim.
Camp.
Yeah.
Kids Week is free.
Yes, Kids
Week. So praise
free.
The Lord for that.
Sign up.
Go participate all week long, the end of June for free. But student camp, you got to pay for. We're bussing them to Eagle Eyrie and Lynchburg. It's going to be a fun week for your students.
Yep.
Studying the Bible, games, activities, food, worship. They're not going to want to miss out, but you're going to want to register them early. So libertylive.church/events is where all these signups are taking place.
Get them signed up early. Save some cheddar. Biscuits.
Cheddar biscuits. Okay.
Yeah. Save some money. Get them signed up. Go check that out on the website. It's all there, all the information. Check it out.
That's right. And invite their friends to join them. Maybe they got friends or cousins or people hanging out this summer. They got nothing to do. Bring them all.
Invite them. Bring them. It's going to be a good time.
Yes, Woo! It is. You know what else is going to be a good time?
Let me guess. Service.
Yes.
Woo!
I'm ready to get to worship this
I'm
morning.
Ready to.
Are
We're
y'all?
Continuing the Follow Me series
yes.
that Pastor Daniel kicked off last week. It's going to be good. We're glad you're here, and we'll see you after.
Good morning, church. It's time to lift our voices and give God our worship. Here we have a culture of songwriting, and this is a new song that our team has written to help us focus our hearts when life is busy. Let's sing this.
We are gathered for this moment and make us ready, and hearts are open. Be enthroned on your praise, your home's on the praise that we receive. In desperation, it brings revival, and we confess we need your power. So come like the wind, let your glory rush in as we sing, as we sing. And we welcome you in Holy Spirit, and we welcome you in this place. And we ask you to and rise among us as we call upon your name, we welcome you.
Come on, put your hands together, come on.
In expectation, in need to wonder, as our praises roar like thunder, we join heaven's sound, our
to your ways, then yes to repentance and grace upon grace. Rain down on your church and swing open the gates. We welcome you. We welcome you. We say yes, come on. We say yes to your presence and yes to your ways and yes to repentance and grace upon.
Says in Psalm 22 that you are enthroned on the praises of your people, God. So, Lord, we ask you, Holy Spirit, to rise among us as we sing your praises this morning. Would you rise among us as we sing your praises?
And Holy Spirit, you are welcome. And come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. 'Cause your glory, God, is what our hearts long for. To be overcome and by your presence, Lord, oh Holy Spirit, you are. We sing it out, God. Place and fill the atmosphere. 'Cause your glory, God, is what our hearts long to be overcome by your presence,
Pastor Grant's God of Miracles series. My brother Jeff, at the young age of 34, became critically ill. He was rushed by ambulance to the hospital and placed in ICU on max life support. The doctor said that if he had waited 4 to 6 more hours, he wouldn't be alive today. It didn't give us much hope. They talked about the long-term conditions that whatever this illness would cause, mainly because his fever got so high. They talked about brain damage. He was in acute kidney failure. They talked about long-term dialysis, kidney transplants, and the list goes on. A few days passed and the test results started getting better. The doctors would sit in their morning discussions about his case, and they would talk about what a miracle that he was becoming. Everyone at the hospital was like, oh yeah, Jeff, he's a miracle. Like, how is this happening? There was no explanation. He was taken off life support after 6 days. A week after that, he was walking out of the hospital and he's on his way to make a full recovery. Y'all, I witnessed a miracle. man doesn't have the final say. Doctors don't have the final say. Praise God. Only God has the final say. I challenge you today, no matter what you're going through, no matter what your walk is, just put your trust in God, and I know that He can perform a miracle in your life.
Chains will never break. again, all the saints. Just in faith, I want you to lift your hands all over this room and lift your prayers to Him, your petition, and know that He receives it like incense and that He's willing and He's able. Go on, sing day and night. Day and night, night and day. Come on, you can give it to Him this morning. Day and night. Night and day, He's done it before, He'll do it again. Night and day, let incense arise. Day and night, night and day, He's ready to receive it. Day and night, night and day, He's willing to receive it. Day and night, night and day, He's able to do.
Is King Jesus worthy of all praise? Yes, He is. Thank you, Jesus. Church, what an honor it is each Sunday that we get to gather together and let our praise rise like incense before the Lord. Day and night, may we worship Him. May we ascribe Him glory. But here's what I word, church, what if we're guilty of this, that we come here on Sunday morning and we shout, Jesus, You're worthy of it all, but then Monday through Saturday, we live like we are. We give glory to all these other things by the way that we live our lives, by the things that we dwell upon, by the words that we speak, by the relationships that we cultivate. You see, our lives are a living sacrifice for Jesus. That's the daily incense that rises up to King Jesus. We're in this series called Follow Me, and that's the call that Christ has placed in front of every single one of us, that we would follow Him. And that starts with a heart that's longing for Jesus, longing for the things of the Lord, walking in obedience. caring for the people around us. So church, may we represent that, not just here this morning, and this is important, but may we represent that in the way that we live our lives, striving after King Jesus. Amen? Amen. Hey, well, we're so glad you joined us here this morning. If it's your first time, welcome to Liberty. Welcome home. This is a family, and we're so glad you're here to worship with us this morning. Let's give a hand for all our first-time guests. If you would, you've got a card in the seat back in front of you. Just fill that out at some point. We'd love to know that you were here. We'd love to connect with you further. But church family, as we get ready to enter now into a time where we hear from God's word in this series called Follow Me, as Pastor Grant brings the word, I want to spend some time in prayer. Can we pray together? King Jesus, we've lifted you high in this place. And Lord, I pray that our worship has been authentic. It's been genuine. Lord, that it hasn't been rooted in pride. That it hasn't been rooted in anything that wouldn't represent the honor and glory that is due your name, Jesus. In any ways that it have, Lord, I pray that you would forgive us, Lord, that we would repent of that. But Lord, beyond just the worship that we display here in this room, Jesus, I pray that we would follow the call to follow you. And Lord, that our lives would be as a daily incense that rises up to you day and night. And Lord Jesus, we know that apart from you, that's impossible because we're imperfect. So we thank you for your sacrifice. We thank you for the blood of Jesus that covers every unrighteous thing for those that follow you. But God, I pray that your spirit would empower us, impress upon us to walk each step in a way that brings you honor and glory, King Jesus. So we submit to you. Lord, I ask that your spirit would move in this time to deliver the word to our hearts in a way that we can take and be changed and moved by the gospel. We love you, Jesus, and we pray this in your holy name. Amen. You can be seated.
Good morning, Liberty. I want to welcome all of the Liberty family and our guests at every campus and those of you who are joining us online. I always like to give a shout out to those, whether you are missionary families or military families, or to the men and women in the Virginia Department of Corrections. It is a joy to bring the Word of God to you today. Who's excited to be in church? Come on, put your hands together. I am so fired up about this message, and take your Bibles and turn with me to Luke chapter 11, and we're in a brand new series, and I'll be talking to you about that in a moment, but you know, we're calling this the year of miracles, and I want you to know God performed a miracle Easter weekend. You heard Pastor Daniel say last week that on Easter, we had like 15,000 people. Well, I want you to know when you look at Friday, Saturday, and Sunday, the weekend, and that's the way churches measure it, Easter weekend, and when you think about it, and really Friday night is one of my favorite services, Good Friday, incredible. But when you look at it, God performed a miracle, and I want to show you the numbers, but I'm a little hesitant to because it can be overwhelming and you can miss the point. So I'm going to ask you to do this. Let me share with you what's on my heart, and don't applaud until the proper time, all right? So don't applaud, all right? But when I came to be your pastor 18 years ago, Brother Art Leary, who was chairman of the committee, asked me on the first week, he said, what's your vision? And I said, I don't know. I'm praying God will give it to me. He said, well, as I pray about it, I believe we could run 20,000 people. And I didn't say it to him, but I began to think, where are we going to park all those cars? And I couldn't see it at the time. But I want you to know, we hit a milestone in ministry, and it's a miracle. It's a miracle. I want to show you what happened on Easter weekend. You ready? We had 20,120 in person Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. We had, at the same time that was going on, 20,189 live, watching it live while the services were going on. All right? Now, to put that in perspective, see, if you don't really think about it, You got to understand, that would be like filling either one of those numbers. By itself, would be like filling the Hampton Coliseum twice. All right? Then at the same time, Monday through Saturday, and we never had this to happen, we had 67,931 to watch it on demand. All right? That's where the word got out. You're telling family members, and they're watching it from around the country. Let me put that in perspective. The largest college football stadium in Virginia is only 65,000. If you put that whole weekend together, that's 108,240 people, and I don't want you to applaud. Listen, I want you to put it in perspective. That would be like filling our largest football stadium, college football, almost twice. That's a miracle. I didn't do that. You didn't do that. God did that, and that's why I want to give you the scripture. Psalm 115:1 says, not to us, Lord, and in case we forget, he said it one more time, not to us, but to your name be the glory. Now give God all the praise. Amen. Hallelujah. And it's not really about the numbers. I want to acknowledge that a miracle took place, and God did it, not us, but it's about the one. Everybody say one. It's like Tim that I told you his story on Easter weekend. He's sitting right over here. I waved at him on the way in. I'm telling you, his story, his parents abandoned him. His grandmother died. At age 11, he started running. He got into a family who was into a gang. He ended up in prison. But look at this. I'm telling you, he met Jesus in that prison cell. And one of our very own who got saved in that same pod, in that same prison, is now taken back. Men's Bible study during the week. Take him back this worship service on Sunday afternoon. And as soon as Tim got out, he came. He's been here except the Sunday he was in the hospital, and he got baptized. It's always about the one. I'm telling you. Heaven rejoices over the one. It's about Brandon and Tiffany. They were baptized. Hadn't been married but 2 months. Brandon never had been baptized. Listen, he dedicated his life to the Lord, their home, their marriage to the Lord. I'm just telling you, heaven rejoices over the one, the one. So you always got to keep it in perspective. It's not about the crowds. It's about following Jesus. And let me just give you these numbers, all right? You ready? You know how we do the survey, A, B, C, and D on Easter? A, we had almost 3,000 people who said, I'm already in a relationship with Jesus. Thank God for that. We had, listen, 367 who said, B, I'm beginning a relationship with Jesus. That's why we do what we do. C, 38 people said, I'm considering it. I'm checking it out. And I want you to know, we're glad you are. We're glad you're here. And we had three who said, I don't ever plan on making that decision. And I want you to know, I prayed for you all today. And I'm just glad you're here and God is at work. I give him all the praise. So the question is, what's your next step? What's your next step? For some, it's to be baptized. You need to sign up to do that. For some, it's to get into a group, and we're starting new group semester today, this week. For some, it's go to Life Track next Sunday. Everybody say next Sunday. That's why you officially become part of the Liberty family. Or parents, sign up your kids, your students, for Kids Week, for Student Camp. Give us your child from birth to 13, and we're going to do everything we can to make sure they have a biblical worldview. A worldview is the way you view the world, all right? And not only is God performing miracles locally, but he's doing it globally. We got a team that's leaving the 19th. This week, they are going to North Africa. And so I want us to pray for this message. Let's pray for that team as we send them out. Father, we thank you for what you're doing. We acknowledge it's only because of you, and you receive all the glory. And Lord, we just pray right now, you prepare our hearts to receive the word of God. Teach us what it means, Jesus, to follow you. And God, I pray because of this team going to North Africa, there will be people who will follow Jesus. We're praying for open doors for the gospel. We're praying for believers there to be encouraged in the faith. And God, we want to pray right now for Israel. You tell us to pray for the peace of Jerusalem. And we pray right now for Israel as they have been under attack. And I thank you that, Lord, we open your word and see in the news what you've already told us. Thank you that you're in control, that you're coming again, Jesus. Move, I pray, the Shekinah glory of God, your presence, right now in these moments, in Jesus' name. And everyone said, amen. All right, in this series called Follow Me, we're going to be doing a topical series, which means I'm going to start at Luke 11, and you're going to have to write down a lot of other passages. And for those of you who get frustrated by that, just hang on. We just did a book series, all right, remember in the book of Ruth. We're going to do another Old Testament and New Testament book series this year. You know why? Because you need all the Bible you can get in an election year. Amen. So we're going to give you lots of Bible book studies, all right? But the most important thing in your life is that you follow Jesus. And Pastor Daniel talked about you start with prayer. You're just talking to God. And so it's an ongoing conversation. It starts early in the morning. It ends at night and happens all throughout the day. You practice his presence. Today, I want to talk to you about Scripture and how to approach Scripture. How do you approach the Bible? All right? And this is, I believe, one of the most important things that I could tell you. In fact, let me just give you this quote. There is no spiritual discipline more important than the daily diet of the milk and meat of the Word. No spiritual discipline more important. You know, I think when you just look at it, these different ways to approach the Word of God, the first way is what you're doing right now. Number one, write it down. You're hearing God's Word, all right? That's what preaching is, hearing the Word of God. In Luke chapter 11, verse 28, are you awake? You with me? Say amen. Blessed, rather, are those who hear the Word of God and obey it, all right? And so Jesus talked a lot about hearing the Word of God. Paul said in Romans 10, faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. And in order for you to hear the Word of God, you have to quiet your heart, all right? We live in a noisy world. And the information age is here to stay, and we're just bombarded all the time. You got to quiet your heart. Now, our high church liturgical brothers and sisters understand the importance of it. That's why they got a sign at all their doors entering the sanctuary saying, quiet. And they believe you come into the sanctuary quiet. And you know what? Their truth is right. Their timing is wrong. They're right that you have to get quiet before the Lord. All right? But remember, the Bible says, and it's always about the Bible. It doesn't matter what man says. The Bible says, enter his gates with thanksgiving, his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and praise his name. That's what that countdown video and the clapping is all about. You entered the way the Jewish people always came to worship, man. They ascended up to the temple, and they were praising God as they entered. Then they went into the outer courts and then made their way to where ultimately only the high priest could go into the Holy of Holies. And so we try to take you on that journey every week. We start out, woo! We got a lot to be thankful for. And then in the next song, we bring it down, and then before it's time to preach, we want you to quiet your heart. And we want you to be ready to receive the Word of God. Have you got it? Say, I got it. You know, there's a place to be still and know that he is God. All right. In fact, I think about what Jesus said about heaven. It's about his presence. He said, where I am, there you can be also. It's about being with him. This week, I knew I was going to be traveling. And Miss Tammy said on Monday, said, can I just go with you? I know you're going to be busy. You're trying to get out of town. But can I just hang out with you today? And she did. And you know what? It's like what we're teaching you about practice, the presence. I was busy. I was talking, but she knew I was there. She could hear my voice. I could hear her voice. She's talking to somebody else. We're talking to one another throughout the day. We wanted to hang out together, spend time together. And that's the way it ought to be with you and God, all right? You're hearing the Word of God. And let me tell you a way you can hear the Word of God is literally when you're getting dressed. You can hear a sermon. 67,000 people last week between Monday and Saturday decided to, on demand, hear the sermon. You can do that driving. Commuting is a great time. Don't waste that time, all right? Then here's the second one, reading God's Word. Reading God's Word. Matthew 19:4, haven't you read? that at the beginning, the Creator made them male and female. Jesus said this often, haven't you read that the stone the builders rejected has become the cornerstone? Haven't you read? And so we read the Word of God. Now, you can't do that without a copy of the Bible. All right, so make sure you got a copy of the Bible. And I heard Donald Whitney wrote a book called Spiritual Disciplines. I'd add that to the list that Pastor Daniel gave you last week. And it's a great book too, all of them about spiritual disciplines. But in it, he tells the story of going on a mission trip, and he got there, and the Christians inside the church, lying, stealing, immorality. He said, then I figured out why. No one had a Bible. No one. No one had a Bible. Now, it's one thing if you don't have a Bible. It's another if it's sitting on a shelf somewhere collecting dust. In fact, the biggest dust storm in America would be if church members would get their Bibles out, get the dust off of them, and start reading them. You got to read your Bible. Look at this. 2 Timothy 3:16. All Scripture. Everybody say all Scripture. Old and New Testament. All Scripture. The writings of Jesus. Of Paul. Peter. John. Listen. All Scripture is God-breathed. It's useful for teaching and rebuking and correcting and training in righteousness. Let me give you these two numbers. 71 hours. You know what that is? How long it takes to read through the Bible. If you took on your app where you can just go and start in Genesis and you let them just read through the Bible, okay, take 71 hours. Let me put that in perspective. That's less than the average American spends a month watching TV. I'm just telling you, you think of the binge watching you do on Netflix or cable news or on your phone. Don't you have 15 minutes a day? 15 minutes a day you will read the Bible through in 1 year. 15 minutes a day. Are y'all getting anything out of the sermon? And so it's so important that you get in the Word. In his book, The Wonder of the Word of God, there was a man in Kansas who was in an explosion, a fire. He lost both his eyes, lost both his hands. He was a new believer, and he hated that he could not read the Word of God anymore, but he heard about a lady in England who used Braille and read the Bible with her lips. He ordered it. He tried it. But the nerve endings on his lips were so damaged, he could not read it. But you know what? One day while he was holding it up, his tongue hit the raised characters. He realized, I can read the Bible with my tongue. And by the writing of the book, he had read through the Bible four times. Now, what's your excuse? 15 minutes a day. Read the Word of God, all right? Here's the next one, number three. Studying the Word of God. You hear it. You read it. You study it. You say, well, is this a progression? No, you need all of it in your life. All of it in your life. Let me give you some scriptures. Ezra 7:10. For Ezra had devoted himself to study and observance of the law of the Lord and to teach the people. You see it in the New Testament, Acts 17:11. Now the Berean Jews were of more noble character. Why? They received the message with great eagerness, and they what? They examined the scriptures every day to see if what Paul said was true. You don't take my word for it or any other preacher's word for it. You get in the book and make sure that what is being preached is the Word of God. All right? Now, let me give you one right here. Maybe the most important verse that I'll give you today. All right, they're all important. But Romans 12:1 says, therefore, I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, offer your, everybody say that word? Bodies. Everybody say it? Bodies as a living sacrifice. Holy and pleasing to God, this is your true and proper worship. Do not be conformed to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, then you'll be able to test and approve what God's will is, his good, pleasing, and perfect will. Now notice the two options you have, conform or transform. There is no option C. A, you conform to this world, you're on the broad road, or B, you're transformed by the Word of God on a narrow path, which just means a narrow way of thinking and living. All right? Now, let me apply that to a modern day issue that parents are dealing with. Gender dysphoria. All right? Now, here it is. Listen, it's real. We live in a broken world. Don't be the church person out there who say, well, hadn't heard in the beginning he made them male and female. I don't understand it. No, you don't understand it because that's not your problem, but you're whacked up in another area. Because we all live in a broken world, right? And so, whether you understand it or not, have some compassion in heart. And here's what I want you to see. Watch this. Watch this. Culture says the answer is what? Change your body to match your mind. Because gender dysphoria is when your mind thinks one thing, but your body looks another. All right? Culture says change your body to match your mind. Scripture says change your mind to match your body. Do you see how powerful and practical this is? So instead of being just judgmental toward people, I mean, you honestly can ask the question in love, what if the world's wrong? Hard to back up after you've changed your body. So what if the world's got it wrong? Instead of changing the body to match the mind, why don't you do what God says and change your mind to match your body? All right? And you're going to change one or the other. If that is an issue, you will change one or the other. And I tell you, the world, I think, has it wrong. And for parents, you're going to have to make up your mind, really, the question, are you going to follow the world or follow the Word? All right? And parents are struggling. And the world's telling you, just let them dress. Now, I'm just telling you. Years down the road, we're going to have a lot of regret. Listen to your pastor. More importantly, listen to God. He says right here in Matthew 7, 24, therefore, everyone who hears these words of mine and puts them into practice, that's the key, will be wise. Like the person who builds his house on a rock. John 8, 32, then you'll know the truth. And the truth will what? It'll set you free. Now, study the Word of God. I got to give you this. It takes a lot of humility. You can't come to the Word of God as a know-it-all. And likewise, you can't gain knowledge and turn around and say, whoo, I'm more spiritual than everybody else. All of these approaches to the Word of God, hearing, reading, studying, listen, they're not barometers of spirituality or maturity. Did you hear that? Say amen. And so it's important that you understand this. Too many of us have been influenced by the Enlightenment period where we were schooled to do what? You read critically, analytically, and you approach the Bible that way. Well, that honestly, the only way I ever read the Bible, and I'm just being honest with you, is with a commentary in one hand or a word study in the other. And that's the only way I ever read the Bible until I met Miss Tammy. And you know what? She read the Bible like a love letter. And she let God speak to her, and she got things out of the Bible. It's not in that commentary. In fact, let me just tell you right now. Listen, man thinks commentary sheds a lot of light on the Bible. The Bible will shed a lot of light on that commentary. I'm telling you. And so you've got to be humble and coming. And it's like a pool. A pool has a shallow end, a middle, and a deep end, right? All right? Again, this is not spirituality. You need all three. When I was a kid, I was in the shallow end. When I learned to swim, I went to the middle. I'm jumping on that diving board in the deep end as a teenager. I'm older in the things of God. I like the shallow end. I'm not jumping off the diving board all the time. You can't live in the deep end. You can't touch. You got to have all three in your life. And truth the matter is, I like the hot tub now. Amen. All right, so here you go. Memorizing God's word. Memorizing God's word. You still awake? Say amen. Amen. Psalm 119, 11. I've hidden your word in my heart that I might not sin against you. Set your mind on things above, not on earthly things. Ephesians 6:17. Take the helmet of salvation, protecting your head, the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. What's going to protect your mind? The Word of God. What's going to be your weapon you use against the enemy? The Word of God. Jesus memorized Scripture, Matthew 4:4. It is written. How did Jesus know it was written? Well, you say, he's God. Yeah, but he was also all man. So he memorized Scripture. Man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. Peter, on the day of Pentecost, Acts chapter 2, verse 16, he had memorized Scripture. This is what was spoken by the prophet Joel. Then in verse 25, David said about him. He's just quoting Scriptures that he's memorized. You say, well, I don't have a good memory. Well, nobody does. All right? But did you remember your Social Security number? Did you remember your phone number? Do you remember your address? Yeah. You can memorize Scripture. Unless there is a mental issue. All right? If you have dementia, you might not can. But I'm just telling you, the reason we don't memorize Scripture is because we don't work at it. You read it over and over again. Write it down. Say it over and over again. That's what Jonathan Edwards did. He used his travel time to write down on just a blank sheet of paper a verse of Scripture, and he would just go over it. And when he got home, he kept going over it until he had it. That's why you memorize Scripture. You write it down. Deuteronomy 6:9, write them on the doorpost of your house. I do believe putting up Scripture in your house is so important. And on your gates. So not only have it on your walls, but I would say that you write it down on paper. I wrote down on a card traveling on a plane yesterday a verse that I want you to memorize, Joshua 1:8. Every adult and every student ought to memorize it, okay? Then I wrote down Psalm 1:1. I'm not preaching something that I'm not practicing, but you got to make yourself do it. You ready? And so you got to get this. Now, memorizing Scripture. I remember my grandfather. He had a country store. That's before Walmart or Target. And in the country store, he would just write on cardboard Scripture and post it on the walls. And as his grandson, I learned a lot of Scripture that way. All right? Just write it down, memorize it. You can do it. Here it is. Meditate on God's Word. Meditate on God's Word. Psalm 119:97. Oh, how I love your law. I meditate on it all the day long. So what keeps you from meditating on Scripture? Noise, hurriedness, busyness. So that's what I said. You got to quiet your soul. You say, well, I don't believe in that meditation stuff. That's Eastern religion. Don't let Eastern religions, false religions, rob us from what the Bible teaches about meditation. Here's the difference. Are you awake? Eastern religion is about emptying your mind. Christian meditation, all right, is about filling your mind. Totally different. In fact, I would put it to you like this. Detachment from the world, that's emptying your mind, is not enough. Attachment to God is the goal. So you're emptying yourself of the world to fill yourself with the Word of God. Now, here it is. We just talked about studying. Studying is what? Analyzing. Meditation is internalizing. You're making this personal. That's why I said, you got to ask your question, am I reading the Bible for information or transformation? Both. Are you reading it like a textbook or a love letter? Both. But the problem with probably the average Christian is we just read it for information like a textbook and for our head. It's got to transform you. This is God's word to you. He loves you. He wants it in your heart. I've still got Miss Tammy's first letter, first card. Let me tell you the difference between a textbook and a love letter. You ready? And we're schooled this way. I read a textbook to find what I got to have to pass the test. And then I forget it. And you did the same thing. You're reading quick, and you're looking for information to pass that test. A love letter, oh, you go with anticipation. You can't wait. Oh, you just savor every word. That's the way Miss Tammy read her Bible every day. I'm over here reading it like a textbook. She taught me how to read it like a love letter. All right? So I think an example would be Mary. Remember Martha and Mary? Mary's at the feet of Jesus. You savor in every word. Martha's busy. I'm too busy. That's why we don't get out of it what we should. Or like Mary, the mother of Jesus, she pondered these things in her heart. Pondered in your heart. In fact, the Bible says in Philippians 4:8, whatsoever things are true, noble, right, pure, lovely, admirable, excellent, praiseworthy, you think, you meditate about these things. Now, here's the verse that I memorized, and I want you to write it down and memorize it, okay? Just write it down, Joshua 1:8. Keep this book of law always on your lips. Meditate on it day and night so that you may be careful to do everything written in it. Then you'll be prosperous and successful. Look at this. Psalm 39:8. My heart grew hot within me when I what? Meditated. The fire burned. Jeremiah said that the word of God was like a fire in his bones. Let me tell you why you don't get out of it what you need. The Puritan pastor, Thomas M. Watson, said this. Thomas Watson said, the reason we come away cold from reading the word is because we do not warm ourselves at the fire of meditation. How many of you have been to the fireplace in the wintertime? You got warm. Before you got across the room to the other side, you were cold. You know why? You didn't stay there long enough. And that's the way it is when we meditate. And literally, it takes two things. Pause and pray. Pause and pray. When you read the Bible, don't read it like a textbook. I got to hurry up and get through with this and get to work. Here it is. Get up early enough where you can read it and say, oh, that phrase really speaks out to me. Just pause. I'm going to meditate there for a minute. Just pray. And then you read on and, oh, that stands out to me. I'm just going to meditate on that a while. Okay? And so meditate. Psalm 1:1. Blessed is the one who does not walk in step with the wicked or stand in the way that sinners take or sit in the company of mockers, but whose delight is in the law of the Lord and who meditates on the law day and night. That person is going to be like a tree planted by the streams of water, which yields its fruit in season and whose leaf does not wither. Whatever they do, what? It prospers. Now, let me tell you the way a plant or a tree grows. It absorbs the water. What's better, a fast, just downpour or a slow rain? Slow rain. That's Miss Tammy reading her Bible. Slow rain. She's absorbing it. I am a thunderstorm. I got things to do, places to be. I got a schedule. I'm in a hurry. And so I'm just being transparent with you. I have to make myself slow down and absorb. Okay? And that's the problem. I always read the Bible sermonizing. All right? Don't let your devotional life be sermonizing or just getting ready to teach a class. All right? Two different kinds of reading. Two different approaches to the Word of God. All right. Well, I want you to see this. Psalm 119:98. Your commands are always with me and make me wiser than my enemies. I have more insight than all my teachers, for I what? That's what meditation does. I meditate on your statutes. All right, I'm getting ready to wrap it up. Applying God's word. You're still awake? Say amen. I want you to read this verse in James 1:22 and listen. Let it speak to you. Do not merely listen to the word and so deceive yourself. Do what it says. Anyone who listens to the word but does not do what it says is like someone who looks at his face in a mirror and after looking at it goes away and immediately forgets what he looks like. That's the way you've read the Bible many times. You've heard a message, read the Bible, walked away from it. After you closed it, you ain't got a clue what you just read. Oh, but whoever looks intently. This is so good. He said, how do I look intently? Hear it, read it, study it, meditate on it. memorize it. Oh, intently. There's an intentionality here. Oh, if you look intently into the perfect law, it'll what? It'll give you freedom. It'll change your mind. And it'll continue. Continue in it and not forget it. You're not going to forget what you've heard. But doing it, you'll be blessed. And whatever you do. I love this quote. Meditation without application is like chewing without swallowing. That's what it means. You got to apply it. What does this say to me today? Now think about it. What does this say to me? How does this apply to me? I don't even know where I'm at in my notes. I'll be honest. I'm just preaching from my heart. But the bottom line is this. What does this have to say to your marriage, your relationships? What does it say to you as a parent? What does it say to you about money, about work, about your business? You read it and say, how does this apply to me and the decisions I have to make today and getting direction for my life? That's it. Here it is. The Bible says, then you'll be blessed. Then you'll be prosperous. Then you'll be successful. That's what I want for me. But as your pastor, that's what I want for you. And that's why the last thing is this. You got to respond to God's word. You got to respond to it. You read it. You hear it. Even if you meditate on it, memorize it, you ultimately have to respond to it. And a response is like this. You can respond by prayer. That's why the altar's always open. That's why we have a response song. You can respond by repenting of a sin that God's put his finger on in your life. You can respond by saying, you know what? There's an act of love, an act of kindness, a word of encouragement that I need to say to somebody else. Make sure you at least respond with one action to what God said to you today. Take your next step. For some of you, it means you're going to start reading your Bible. For some of you, while you're getting ready or driving, commuting back and forth to work, you're going to start hearing the Bible. Are you with me? But everybody's got to respond in some way, and that's why we have this time of response. And ultimately, the series is Follow Me. Here it is. You're not following religion. Not following a denomination. You're not even following a set of teachings. You're following a person, and his name's Jesus. He said, follow me. It's real. It's going to change your life. You'll never be the same. And everybody's following someone. Everybody's following someone. So who are you following? You're either following the crowd, you're following the culture, or are you following Christ? Won't you bow with me for prayer? Right where you are, if you need to begin a relationship with God, you're coming to God for the very first time, or maybe you've gotten away from God and you need to come back to God, just pray a prayer in your heart, something like this. Just say, God, I believe that the greatest miracle of all is knowing you. Thank you, Jesus, for making a way for me to know the one who made me. I believe, Jesus, that you are the living word, that you died on the cross to pay for my sin, that you rose from the dead on the third day. Thank you for giving your life for me. Right now, I give my life to you. I want to follow you all of my days. Speak to me through your word and guide me. In Jesus' name, and everyone said, amen. Can we rejoice with those who prayed that prayer? Come on, every campus. And we want to hear from you. Take the response card at our campuses, and you can fill it out, put it in the offering basket as you leave. or you can just text YES to 40371. And of course, if you call Liberty Home and you have an offering, you can put it in the basket, or just text GIVE to 40371. But I want you right now just to respond to what God said to you in the message today. So let's stand, every campus and location. The altar is going to be open. I'm going to pray for you. And I want you to put it into practice. I want you to go write down Joshua 1:8 on a card like your pastor did. Carry it around with you all week. And just ask God to speak to you and help you memorize it. Let's pray. Father, thank you for your word to us today. And I thank you that forever, O Lord, your word is settled in heaven. I thank you that there's power in the word, power to change us, to make us more like you. And so I pray right now that as people respond and call on your name, that you will hear their prayers and answer their prayers. You know everything going on in their lives. And I pray that you give them the guidance, direction that they need. I thank you that your word is a lamp unto our path, our feet, our light to our path. I thank you that you're our shepherd, Jesus. You lead us in paths of righteousness for your name's sake. So I'm praying right now that we would leave this service today, our time together, just loving the word, learning the word, and I pray that you'd help us to live it. In Jesus' name, and everybody said, amen.
church, this morning we have four baptisms, and I can't say enough about these powerful living testimonies that we're going to baptize this morning. God has just been at work. Despite what the enemy tries to do, we know that the battle is already won in Jesus' name. Up first, we have Noah, and Noah is fearless. He doesn't know a stranger, and most importantly, he knows Jesus really well, and he knows that Jesus died for him and rose on the third day. And he knows the meaning of baptism. He knows that it's a symbol to show the world that he is saved and following Jesus. So my brother, it's my privilege to baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Buried with Christ in baptism, raised to walk into life. Up next, we have Clara. And you can come up. When Clara was young, about Noah's age, actually, she heard the gospel for the first time. And one of the things that really kind of captured her attention was the aspect of the possibility of going to hell. And the fear that that brought in her life was immense. But after some time and continuing to go into church and just developing in her relationship with Jesus, she learned more about heaven. And not just the possibility of heaven, but the fact that she could have an abundant life and relationship with Jesus right here on this earth, and then spend an eternity with a God that she already knows and loves. So she wants to get baptized today, just as a symbol and demonstration of the conquering of that fear and the true relationship that she has with Jesus. Going to church with mom and grandparents, that's fine, praise God for it. But it doesn't mean as much as actually becoming saved and for your relationship with Jesus to really be your own. So my sister, it's my privilege to baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Faith in Christ and baptism. Grace to walk in newness of life. Amen. Up next, we have Fallon. And Fallon was sharing with us that she actually struggles with anxiety. And sometimes it would get to the point where it would literally be crippling and paralyzing. But Fallon knows that she finds strength in Jesus. And whenever she relies on him and leans on him, it's a completely different day and experience than life apart from Jesus. So she was baptized as an infant, but today she wants to get baptized to show the world that she doesn't have to be anxious anymore. She doesn't have to fear anymore, but she relies and puts her trust solely on him. My sister Fallon, it's my privilege to baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Bear with Christ in baptism, raised to walk in newness of life. And last but not least, we have Samantha. Samantha was explaining her testimony in the back, and she said that she actually struggles with bipolar and attempts of suicide. And it was just a real meaningful moment in the back, because I was explaining to her how recently lost three loved ones due to suicide. And many of them did not get the help and the attention that they needed. However, she is. She has a loving husband that is there to support her. And she has a growing relationship with Jesus Christ. And I don't take it for granted that many of the people we had come for baptism today struggled with suicide, depression, anxiety, bipolar, and these different things. And I don't take it for granted that there may be some of you that struggle with the same exact thing. And I want to tell you today that there is hope in God. And I want to encourage you to continue to trust in Jesus. Your life has value. And if there's anything that I could say to somebody that is struggling with that, is that the people here, your church, your body, your community, your family, they love you. And they want to see you live abundantly and to live out your days. So continue to follow Christ and lean on Him. And if you know anybody that is struggling, continue to pray for them and make sure that they get the help that they need. My sister Samantha, it's my privilege to baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Bear to Christ in baptism. Praise the Lord, Jesus Christ.
Grateful that you joined us for worship today. What a powerful message on following Jesus through reading His Word and through Scripture. If we can help you take your next step today, please don't hesitate to let us know. You can text YES to 40371. You can scan that QR code on the screen or visit us online at libertylive.church/connect.
Whatever the next step is, maybe you want to know more about the church, baptism, salvation, whatever it is, let us help you.
That's right.
Fill out the connection card. Let us know what that next step looks like for you. We'd love to help you take it.
Yep. Even if it's just prayer, you can put your prayer request in there, and we will follow up with you this week. Either send you an email, give you a call, whatever you're comfortable with, and just pray with you, for you. So it's our honor to do that.
That's what we're here for.
That's right.
Yes.
And speaking of ways that you can take your next step, the group semester
starts
today for the spring. It runs through June 22nd. So if you're ready to get plugged in with community, libertylive.church/groups. Mm-hmm. We've got groups in person that meet all over Hampton Roads, and we also have online groups if you aren't present in person in Hampton Roads. You can do it online.
Yep. Something for everybody. And speaking of something for everybody, don't forget to sign up your students and your kids for Kids Week and VBS. Well, just Kids Week.
Kids Week, yep.
Kids Clubs at VBS.
Yes.
And Student Camp.
That's right.
All happening this summer. Both big weeks for the kids and students. It's going to be fun. Check out the information on the site.
That's right.
It's all there. Sign them up.
LibertyLive.church/events is where you can find a list of everything we've got going on. And as always, you can stay connected with us all week long in the online campus family group on Facebook.
Yep.
We'd love to see you there, pray with you, connect with you. And we hope that you have a blessed week, y'all.
Yes, we do. Online fam, we love you. Have a great week, and we'll see you next time.